So let's go ahead and get started then. So I think that the hope is that I just wanted to spend a little bit of time kind of having like an informal discussion as to, now that all of you have done research, some of you have done an RU or a TEU this last summer, to kind of discuss what's the next step, sort of what to think about either for next summer or even for a little bit after that. So what I've done here on the slide behind us is put up a link to one of the places of the NAM website. If you actually go to miscellaneous links at the top of the NAM website, then here we have a list of some RUs that you might want to consider. Really, this abbreviated list here is for those RUs that I'm aware of that are typically pretty friendly to underrepresented minorities. So I believe that the first one, great, I can't see without my glasses, is for Cal State University Channel Islands. Those of you who know Cindy Wiles, this is the RU that she runs every other year. It's particularly friendly to Dreamers. So you don't necessarily have to be a US citizen to be a part of this RU. A lot of RUs are technically NSF funded, and they're very picky about kind of where their funding goes. Let's see, another couple that are up here are Morgan State University has its Spiral program. That's kind of considered to be like a pre-RU, so they really cater more towards students that are perhaps freshmen or sophomores that are more interested in learning about what an RU is. And they focus more on kind of more projects and kind of more introductory topics in mathematics before they do really getting into hardcore research. And William Dula, you were in Spiral a couple of years ago, is that right? So certainly if anyone has an interest in kind of learning more about Spiral, then I recommend you talk to Mr. Dula back here. There's also my program, this is at Purdue University, so I call it PRIME, Purdue Research and Mathematics Experience. We're not going to really run it for 2018 next summer, but we're going to run it the summer after that. And we're more interested in either number theory, algebraic geometry, or probability and statistics. And I'll let Dr. Frankel here say a little bit about MSRIO.
Yes, which is one of the programs that you can see on the screen. And also, yesterday I was sharing brochures, and I have more today. If you didn't get a chance to take one, would you please ask me after the panel and take some? The MSRIO app has been around for more than 10 years, actually 11 this summer of 2017. And we actually have a very good record of recruiting and mentoring underrepresented minorities so that they stay in the mathematical sciences and continue on to graduate school and complete their graduate school. We have several components. Like many REU programs, we are also funded by NSF, but like many REU programs, there is a research component that takes place during the summer. We add a lot of layers to that summer experience. There are workshops about skills, typesetting in mathematics, how to do oral or poster presentations. There are workshops about searching databases, journals in the mathematical sciences, how to write for publication. There are panels about graduate school, how to apply to graduate school, how to get funding for graduate school. There are panels about careers in the mathematical sciences or careers for people that have a strong backgrounds in mathematics. Mm-hmm. We invite speakers every week to talk about the research, usually very, very excellent resources from very diverse backgrounds. They share their experiences doing research as well as their personal journeys, how they shape their careers, decisions they made, choices they made. We have also lunch conversations that are more informal, where some of the guests come and talk about, again, their work, their choices. We explore a lot of issues. Usually the students ask about these issues that are typical for members of underrepresented communities or students who are from first generation to go to college, like imposter syndrome, stereotype threat. These things come naturally in the conversations because most of the people that passes through the program, whether it is the research team or the guests, visitors, are people who also come from diverse backgrounds, from diverse institutions, who have chosen different pathways in terms of careers in the mathematical sciences. I don't know if I'm thinking too much or I can keep going.
No.
Okay, let me keep going. I just want to touch on something that was said yesterday on the panel about graduate schools, like do you research, see how long students take to finish their PhDs? Was the record actually getting students finishing their PhDs? So I have my numbers also for the MSRIRAD, for the summer program. On the first 10 years of the program, nearly, well, 45, almost 46% of our past participants have been women, so we actually try to keep that balance, or at least approach that. 81% of our past participants have come from underrepresented minority groups. 58% come from small departments that have little or not or zero opportunities to do research in-house. As well, of the students who have finished their bachelor's, because they come to us when they are still in college. So of the students that have finished their bachelor's after they left the program, nearly 82% have gone on into graduate school. So we have a good record. We also have numbers of students that have finished the PhD, have finished their master's. We have 20 students that or alumni that have finished their PhDs already and have entered the workforce. Many of them are in academia, not all of them. 56, 54, I think, are masters, and most of them are continuing on to the PhD. So the numbers speak for themselves, and this is looking at the first 10 years of the program. It's only been 10 years.
So 10 years?
It's
right,
only,
right.
Yeah, but it's only been 10 years. Instead of tracking, right, students who joined us 5 years ago, you know, we cannot tell where they are going to end up because they are still in graduate school. So. So it's just the numbers have started to, you know, show the pattern, but I think we have a strong record. And I spoke already about the summer component, but then beyond the summer, we try to give the students the opportunity to present at least at 2 national conferences after the summer experience. We have some preferred places that we like the students to go or encourage them to go. SAGNAS, the Society for the Advancement of Chicanos Hispanics and Native Americans, which is coming up in October, later this month. NAM is one of them. The joint mathematics meetings in January. Students also sometimes reach out for support because they want to go to local conferences or other national conferences that are in the radar. But we definitely commit to offer them or support them and make sure they get at least through 2 opportunities to present at the national level. The person that runs that particular summer program when the student participates keeps this long-term mentoring relationship. So this person is, you know, keeping in touch with the students. It's about time to start applying for graduate schools. Let me help. I'll revise your statement, letters of recommendation as appropriate, as well as letters from the research leader, which is different from the people that actually do some of the administrative work. Through the process, once they apply, recommending places that they could be a good fit for, once they receive invitations or acceptances to graduate programs, helping them make choices, and actually people who are just finishing graduate school and looking for jobs, they continue to reach out to the former mentors, or actually their mentors, because they become career mentors, for advice on where to apply, how to apply, what should be part of the package. The early experiences as a junior faculty or postdoc, where you also have to still learn from more senior members of the professional community. Learn to say no, learn to pick, you know, your battles, and all, you know, there's so many things. It's never ending. It's actually the mentoring relationship is always needed at any stage of your academic or professional career, and it actually doesn't end. Because we have 5 co-directors running the program, all of us are from different institutions across the nation, different types of institutions. And the one from a community college, we have people from PhD granting, HBCU, and all different. We really bring diversity to it, even though one of us, not all 5, but only one of us is actually there in the summer and develops a closer mentoring relationship with that cohort. But the larger group of program directors are part of the larger network and the larger mentoring support group for those students. And our own networks, right? Whatever professional organizations I'm part of, any other projects I'm part of, we are all adding. So that's also very special about our model, because the more typical REU programs have that one person or team that are, you know, running the program and they do this every summer, and it could be very, you know, exhausting to keep track of who has been there for how long, who is where. So we pick those cohorts, and every 5 years you have your own, you know, cohort, but you are always there for everybody else. It's that
yeah,
makes
no,
sense.
Okay.
I don't know.
Can you also a little bit about MTBI?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
The Mathematical, let's say MTBI, Mathematical and Theoretical Biology Institute, which has been around much longer. Oof, the first one was at Cornell. It's been 20 years. Now that I remember, it's been more than 20 years. Okay.
Okay.
So MTBI started at Cornell and is now in Arizona,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
It's run by Carlos Castillo Chavez. It's also one of those programs that have been outstanding at recruiting and mentoring underrepresented minorities. They do have a single area of work, which is the intersection of math and biology. I was a graduate student at the inaugural MTBI. Another excellent program. Many of the participants of the program are now, you know, my colleagues, professors everywhere. We see them at SAGNAS all the time. So that's another family within the larger family of REUs that pay special attention to underrepresented women and minorities. But because I mentioned MTBI, which is focused on one particular area, I want to say that the MSA write-up at at Berkeley, California, the research topic changes every year because we invite a different researcher every year. Next year is the mathematics of data science. Traditionally, in REU programs, you want to give the students an authentic research experience, but authentic research, you know the starting question, but you don't know when or how this is going to end. So we got to add some control to the experience. We want to make sure the students have something to report at the end of just 6 weeks. So we invite researchers who have experience mentoring undergraduate students as well as experience with REUs. So they understand that they got to bring authentic research problems, but they got to be accessible to the students who are still in, you know, undergrad, and they have to be able to produce something in 6 weeks. Usually, that intent of having some control and a successful experience at the end reduce the type of problems that are offered to students. And they have to be problems under the area of expertise of that research leader. So next year is special. For data science, the research mentor is gonna give students the option to pick their problem. He's gonna have some plan B problems, but he's gonna give the students the option to pick their problems. So students who have an interest in social justice issues or environmental science or any other areas or disciplines of life, they could try to propose a problem. And of course, it's gonna be limited by the skills that will be developed during the program, the accessibility to data, right? It has to be something for which we can get data quickly and get to it. But it's gonna have that special aspect, which is not common. Usually the professor comes and he has some problems that he suggests to the students.
Okay. Excellent. Would anyone else like to add to this list of REUs or other experiences? You know, certainly we're not saying that we know everything, but certainly we have enough experts here in the room, we can maybe add a few.
Or anything about the MSA write-up that might be important, and anything that I may have on me.
Okay.
Please.
I also want to ask you about on the website, it says Computational Sciences Institute. Can anybody explain that?
Oh, well, this year, that's more of a NAM activity that we still have to kind of announce because it hasn't been completely planned yet. But yeah, that's a specific NAM activity, not really an REU.
But is that, I guess, of course, would that be open, like when it happens to, is that geared towards undergrads or graduate students or anybody?
It's really going to be open for everyone. So we're really going to focus more on students and faculty together. So it's supposed to be kind of like a pre-REU type of experiment where we'll have a week-long workshop,
mm-hmm.
and then students can come in, they can learn about different background and, say, different topics of mathematics that
nice.
We haven't decided upon yet. Also have training in various computer packages,
so
R, Sage, Mathematica, what have you. But then certainly we'd like to have faculty there as well if they'd also like to have the same type of training. But yeah,
okay.
We haven't officially announced it yet, so we're still working on that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Ron, you want to say something?
I would say for the faculty in the room, MAA has a program called REU Up, where you can basically run a small REU locally. I remember is the Mount St. Mary's REU still running?
Oh,
I don't think, unless they restarted it, they straight stop for a few years. That was good because it had, there aren't as many things
for
fresh.
Yeah, St. Mary's of Maryland still has their REU. They're for younger.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure their webpage implies that there's still
there.
This is Dave Kahn's REU.
Exactly.
Right.
I think it's.
I just sent you an email about that, Ed, right? Because I
haven't
been on your list.
Is it all that?
Sorry, I'm looking for the REU 11.
I did my research at NASA, right? That's the, and they have some opportunities for math in NASA. For the site, you look at, I think it's called OSSI. So if you look at NASA OSSI, and so they have this kind of big centralized system, I guess kind of NASA thinking, where they have for all their trying to put into all the opportunities in the country, so everything from everybody from junior high school students to postdocs, it was the idea of trying to put everything in the system. But they are supposed to be a number of opportunities for minority students there. I know that even at NASA GIS, which is there's a small branch of NASA here in New York City, right, which is the one where I work at. It's next to and we have several interns each year there. The deadline for this, I'm not sure whether the deadline for this year is passed or not, but it's something to look into the actual list. Because they have their programs in which they have both high school teachers, they have high school teachers, undergraduates, for instance, at GIS, in a program where they work with small groups.
I just want to note for any students who are not yet seniors, apply for REUs. Don't limit yourself to these. There are lots and lots of REUs. You can just Google it. AMS has a list of them. There are lots of others. You can, look at the pictures, look at the subjects. The subject areas often change. See if there's something that interests you. But they have gotten competitive, so don't just apply to one. Apply to, at least a handful to make sure you get something, because they're really, it's a great experience.
Yeah, that's true. That just reminded me of something which was pointed out at this same other program I was at. Even if you don't succeed on your first application, often, like a number of people, they, on the second try, they get through the same program. So that thing about apply to many, but also don't be shy to apply again.
That is correct.
You've gotten yourself to the point where now you're ready for that program.
Right. Okay, Tracy?
So I see you're on the website now, and I don't know if this is on the website, but there's a program at Caltech called CERP. And they have opportunities at NASA, JPL, and I think they also post math research opportunities. And so that's definitely something like you should apply to if you're not.
Right.
Right.
The Caltech CERP is actually very nice in that you can be from outside of Caltech and apply to work with a Caltech faculty member, and you can really do it in lots of different areas. So even if something isn't really posted online, if there's a faculty member you want to work with, you can always just try to contact that person directly. And there is money to pay for it.
Let's mention a couple in particular. We've had good luck with a program at NC State. They have an REU in applied mathematics that has been eager to have our students. We've had some good experience with that. There's one at Michigan State in experimental mathematics. And that one's good in that it's geared towards students who are, may not have reached the stage of the proof-based coursework, but just a solid calculus student, they invite them into their own projects, talking discrete math topics that they can introduce them to and engage them quickly. I think that SU And last one, it's not an REU, but Park City Mathematics Institute. They've been eager for some years, with some up and down. But it's I've always heard good things about it. Haven't been myself, but the festival, some just activity of people in mathematics at various different levels. And one good thing about that, aside from just being a good experience, is that they will take seniors who have graduated, whereas REU programs in general want you to be returning as a new graduate following fall. They would, it's a shorter experience, 3 weeks, but someone heading off to a graduate program, looking for something worthwhile but maybe not as intense, then this could be good.
I've done that. I heard City, that program is just terrific. It's wonderful at any level, any
So let me try to follow up on some of these. For Park City, you can actually go to the website here, pcmi.ies.edu. It's a little bit confusing because they still have information about the 2017. They should have the 2018 up soon. There's actually lots
what
of
is,
activities.
What is Park City Math Institute, right?
It's in Park City, Utah. It's just outside of, this is in the city of Park City, right? But I'm trying to think of the big city here. But what I wanted to say is that there actually are lots of activities that take place. There are things for graduate students. There's other things for undergraduates. There's things for faculty. There's also things for K-12 teachers. So you don't want to be intimidated by kind of how much happens here, but there are different opportunities if you go to Park City here. There also was mention about REU sites. In case you did not know, REU is technically a term that was created by the National Science Foundation. And really, technically, to be an REU, you really have to be funded by NSF. So NSF is great about actually having all of their REUs listed online. You really just do a search, NSF REU, and you should be able to see a complete list of all of the different REUs that have active funding through NSF. But everything is here online.
So I don't know whether or not we did this, but I just wanted to, did we recognize? I just wanted, I'm putting you on the spot. I just wanted to recognize sort of Emma Ben, who's Director of Academic Programs for the Center of Biostatistics and Co-Director for the MS Program in Biostatistics and Program Director of the MPH in Biostatistics for Population Health and Health Science Policy at the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai. So we just wanted to welcome.
I did ask Dr. Ben to maybe come here and say a little bit about perhaps opportunities for undergraduates in the biosciences.
Sorry,
I should say biostatistics. So, do you want to say a little bit?
Okay, sure. Actually, I'll pull up the website for the program I was going to tell you about. So, first of all, good morning. So the NSF has a lot of opportunities for mathematical experiences. But also the NIH sometimes has some opportunities for you. So much of the work I do tends to be more in the longs of the NIH. However, I did get a doctoral dissertation grant from the NSF when I actually was doing my dissertation a while ago. But anyway, so I wanted to tell you about a program that I started when I was a doctoral student. It was maybe my first year of the doctoral program in biostatistics at Columbia University when I was there. And at the time, I was it in terms of diversity, right? There were no diverse faculty. Actually, the chair of the Department of Biostatistics now is Dr. Du Bois Bowman, who is actually a black man, right? But at the time, he was not there. And so I was thrust kind of into this program because I had done my MPH, my Master's of Public Health in Columbia. Another time, maybe I can tell you how I had kind of this weird nonlinear trajectory to biostatistics. I wasn't like you guys sitting here as an undergrad thinking about what mathematical programs I would do in the summer. I was a chemistry major initially. But what I wanted to say was that while I was there, I was not exposed to biostatisticians of color, right? the department was primarily Asian in terms of the faculty and in terms of the students, and so I felt a bit isolated at times. In my master's of public health, I was in a different department at Columbia, and it was very, very, very diverse. I mean, everybody was there. So when I got there, I would try to say hello to students. They would kind of walk right by me. There were a lot of like cultural differences. You know, I'd hear students talk about my hair, whatever, like whatever they had to say. And I also felt that because I was not able to speak Chinese, I was not able to actually establish like a relationship with the faculty that I saw some of the other students being able to establish. Like when you're going into a doctoral program, you're there for years, right? And you have, a lot of times you begin to establish relationships with faculty. Sometimes they invite you over for Thanksgiving, like whatever it is. And I didn't feel I was able to do that. I wanted to be able to do that and have a network of students. So while I was there, you know, I was doing a statistical inference problem set, and it would take me like hours to do. And so I had a lot of time to think. And at the time I was very much wondering why I didn't see us. Like, why were we not there? And maybe it's because I never took my first statistics class until I was in a master's program. Like, we take our multivariable calc, we take our linear algebra, we take all of these high level math classes, but for some reason statistics was never, sometimes you don't even have like people teaching a stats course in a math department. Like, it's just, it's not always as emphasized. And so I kind of felt like maybe we weren't there just because we didn't have as much exposure. And so I went to the department chair with another student. He was Vietnamese and felt like he was a little isolated because he wasn't Chinese, right? It was, you know, it's all good. So he was on this mission to help me get more people who look like me to the field. And so I went to the department chair at the time. It was Dr. Bruce Levin. And it was like in the evening, maybe like 6 p.m. And I was like, can I just ask you a quick question? And so we were like, you know, what if we did like a summer program or something? Like something to just expose undergraduates of color who have, or just disadvantage. I mean, undergraduates of color, but first generation students, those who are economically disadvantaged, it's not always this, right? There are a lot of us who are trying to get into, go to higher education, and we don't really have a path. Like, I didn't know what a dissertation was, right, until I started doing it. Versus if you have mentors around you who are able to say, this is how it works, this is what you should do, you should do internships, you should do this, right? I was working while I was in school, so I was getting a lot of experience on the job. But Dr. Levin was open to listening to what I had to say, and he was like, you know, we've been thinking about like the lack of diversity, but we just never had anyone who really wanted to do, who knew how to do something about it. And that's frustrating too, because you don't want to wear the whole burden. I mean, I was like wearing this whole burden of like, oh my gosh, if I don't make it out this program, I'm gonna mess it up for every person of color who tries to get through. I mean, really, like you feel like, but anyway, he said, look, if you guys put something together, we'll support you. And so the department gave us, I think we begged for like, we got like maybe $30,000, something like that summer through the department. We went to the dean's office, the dean of the School of Public Health, because the biostatistics department is in the School of Public Health at Columbia. We begged them for money. We begged the student affairs office to come and tell students about admissions to graduate school. We got Kaplan GRE to like do like volunteer GRE classes for the students. I taught statistical computing and SAS. Another student, I think that was Gary at the time, he taught introduction to biostatistics. We begged faculty to mentor students. And we also said we wanted to be social. We know that a lot of times, you know, depending on where you come from, you don't get to get exposure to everything out there. We wanted to make sure we created a community. And so, I mean, we were going to like Broadway plays, whatever. Whatever we could get our hands on. And That first summer, we piloted it with City College mathematics majors. Somehow, out of the blue, as soon as it was over, it was a really big success. It was a lot of work, but there was an NIH funding solicitation for something like biostatistics summer program, something about diversity. It was like it had fallen from the heavens. And we worked with our faculty to really push that forward, and that we ended up getting an R25, an NIH R25 grant the next summer, and that program went for 5 years and was renewed for another 5 years. So this will be the 10th year. So don't do the math about when that means I was there, right? So let's think about 10 years ago or so. And we're hoping that it will continue. So I just wanted to show you a little bit about the program. It's called the Best Diversity Program at Columbia. Okay. It is the best, no. But anyway, so this is one of our earlier cohorts. But anyway, you can go, you can learn more about it. You're gonna have research experiences. This is a little big, okay. So anyway, it's sponsored, it's within the Department of Biostatistics, and it's at the Columbia University Mailman School of Public Health. When we got the NIH funding, when we first started, we did 1 month, students commuted. When we got the NIH funding, it's 2 months. You live in the international house, so I don't care if you live in Bed-Stuy like me, you get to go and take your stuff, pack your stuff up, and go to the international house, which is right around the Columbia University Morningside Heights campus. So near 116th Street. You're there with your cohort and a whole host of students who are there in the summer, but you actually get a stipend, because one of the things was that typically students have to work in the summer. And so if we're gonna make this opportunity, we have to make sure that you can do this opportunity without feeling like, how are you gonna make money, right? And so I think the stipend is about $2,800, something like that, for 2 months. And you actually go, you take classes, you also will get to listen to research seminars. I typically give at least one lecture per summer. But you get research seminars from a lot of different faculty, and you're really learning about biostatistics, and you're learning about its applications to kind of biomedical and public health research. So you're doing your classes, you're listening to research seminars, you're getting GRE training. You're also going to be hooked up with mentors. You're gonna work on a capstone project so that by the time you're end, you wanna have a deliverable, and this should be something that you're thinking about whenever you're working with any mentor. You wanna make sure that when you're done, you have something to say, like, I did something. Many of the students go off into graduate programs. Some of them have gotten accepted into the biostatistics program, epidemiology programs, and are thriving. So I think since then, there's been about 110 students or so that have passed through. But I will send information. There are also other programs. Harvard has a summer program that's more kind of along kind of computational programming and biostatistics. There are a lot of opportunities. So if you're interested in learning about biostatistics in terms of it being a subfield of statistics where you're applying things to biomedical research, I do a lot of things trying to understand or use causal inference to look at disparities, because why is it that if we have access to care, why we see people still struggling, right? And you think that it's common sense, but we still have to do the research to do it. So it's a really interesting way to apply your math. If you are a science major and you're trying to understand how do I merge my science and my math, it's a really good way to do it. So I am hopefully going to partner with Medgar Evers to try to get more exposure and do whatever I can for MS and biostatistics program or whatever, lectures, whatever, to get you more interested. I also want to tell you just briefly, because I know I've overdone my time, but I want to tell you, I co-chair the joints, the international, the Eastern North American region of the International Biometric Society. We call it ENAR. But we have a Fostering Diversity in Biostatistics workshop, and that happens every March. We do give a stipend, it's like $800, and it happens wherever that ENAR conference is happening. So this coming March, it's going to be in ATL. I mean, who can't not want to go to ATL, right? So it's going to be in ATL, but it is a workshop where you get exposed to learning, like, what is biostatistics? What are the career opportunities in biostatistics? I'm an academic, but biostatisticians are in the pharmaceutical industry, they're in the government, they're working for the US Census, the Department of Health, they're everywhere. So that is an opportunity for you to apply for and just come and learn and get to exposure to other biostatisticians. And there is also something called the Joint Statistical Meetings Diversity Mentoring Program. And that is also another thing where you can actually get hooked up with a mentor to kind of guide you through the process. So these are all things that I'm a part of in addition to the Math Alliance, but I really do hope I will get this information. I will get it to professors. Hopefully you can distribute it. But I really do encourage you to apply, and you can start applying for the ENAR Fostering Diversity in Biostatistics workshop like now. So, yeah. Okay?
All right. That was great. I put you on the spot every single time.
I'm sorry.
What does she do if she gets to
find? So, yeah, thanks for that. Does anyone else want to make any comments, announcements, or ask any questions?
So, of the students who have already done an REU, I want to, you might have talked about this on Friday, graduate research scholarship program.
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, if you want to say a quick word, please.
For, the person who runs the program at National Science Foundation said, if I'm coming here, I must give students brochures. So, National Science Foundation will fund you up to $13,000 per year for 3 years of graduate school to get access to supercomputers. It's a very, very prestigious program. When you have an NSF GRFP, the grad school you go to also gets money. So you can basically, if you have a GRFP, basically any grad school will accept you because they're actually getting money from you to go. So if you're a student, I'd love to give you these.
I want to make a comment, yeah. It's beyond the REU. Theme of the panel. Okay, so I don't know if you realize we're really targeting the student and trying to help you take advantage of opportunities. Membership in professional organizations is vital.
Yeah.
You probably got it here, right? Through these 2 days, like, oh my God, I'm learning so much from so many other people. And it's vital even for us that are already, you know, finished through graduate school, have our jobs, have tenure. I took notes in this day and a half. I missed the first half day, but day and a half. I took notes of things that I didn't know, people that I didn't know. I'm going back to my home institution, and I have to advise the students, and then I have more information that is relevant to my student population. I also work with other faculty members, my junior, that I need to mentor. So again, I'm bringing information for junior faculty members of my institution. I'm joining NAM. I'm gonna sign up as a member. This was my first NAM. So I just want you to get that maybe this was sponsored by the REU program that you went to in the summer, by your school, but you wanna think about that. You wanna think about just, you know, making that decision to join professional organizations, even if you don't have perhaps the support of the institution, or go try to get it so that you can pay those dues, but stay connected to professional organizations. That's all I wanted to say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, that sounds great. So maybe we should close out the panel here. So I want us to have some time at least to have the problem solving session later and maybe take a little break. So why don't we then take a break until, let's see, about 11 o'clock. I can't really see what the glare is.
10 minutes.
Yeah, about 10 minutes. Right, but I do want to thank everyone who had a chance to say a few words here. So let's just give everyone a round of applause.